Wiesel cycle is quite often known. Diesel cycle is an approximation of what happens in a diesel engine, which is quite often known as an oil engine. And you say that, look, all these oils, diesel, petrol, are petroleum fractions, come out of refining of crude oil. And you say that petrol, because most of our students have a reasonable background in chemistry, including organic chemistry, tell them that these are alkanes, that is hydrocarbons. Petrol is typically C8, that is octane type, whereas diesel is between C10 and C11, C10 or C12, the decane type. Okay. So, diesel has a higher molecular weight, so it will have a higher boiling point, higher evaporation point, and it will be a heavier fuel. Tell them that because petrol has a lower boiling point, it will mix very easily with air. If you bring a can containing petrol and leave it open in the classroom, within a minute or so, the whole classroom will start smelling petrol. But that's not true of diesel. You open a can of diesel, it takes quite some time before people start realizing that there is a diesel can open. And because of this, it is not possible to do a pre-mixing of petrol and diesel vapor. It's not so easy to vaporize diesel. So what is done is the following. The idea is you take an auto type of engine, that means a reciprocating engine. What you do is compress only the air. So take in air, compress it. And when you compress it isentropically, you will reach some state 2. If this is state 1, after compressing, you will reach state 2. Now, at this stage, as it reaches state 2, inject a spray of diesel. This is a fine technology by itself. Earlier, we used to have individual injectors on individual cylinders. Now, we have what is known as a common rail injection system. A high pressure duct containing diesel oil is created using a high pressure pump. And then you have nozzles with valves at the entry of every cylinder. Whenever is required, you just open that turn valve, so it's opening the nozzle and spraying a very fine mist of diesel into the cylinder. So this spray of diesel is liquid. First it will mix with air. The air is hot, so it will evaporate. And after evaporation, the vapor will mix in appropriate proportion. And then because of the high temperature, the temperature here is pretty high, it will burn. There is no spark needed, and that is why the diesel engine quite often is known as a compression ignition engine. And the petrol engine is known as a spark ignition engine. And then you say that all these processes, dispersal of droplets in air, their evaporation and mixing of vapor and air, and the mixture finding itself at the correct temperature and the correct pressure, correct concentration, takes some time. The piston doesn't have patience to wait. It is connected to the crank, so it starts moving. So what happens is, combustion tries to increase the pressure, the piston movement tries to decrease the pressure. The net resultant is something in between, and in a basic diesel cycle, it is modeled as a constant volume process. So 2 to 3 is the constant volume heat addition by compression ignition of diesel, and tell them that this constant volume is only an approximate model. Sorry, constant pressure. Combustion tries to increase the pressure, expansion tries to decrease the pressure. Approximate constant pressure heat addition. This is a model for analysis. Okay. In actual practice, it doesn't happen like that. After that, the remaining stroke is used for expansion. Again, exhaust valve opens and the remaining part take place, including the exhaust as well as, I am exaggerating this loop, but you have a positive loop and a negative loop. The other part is almost like a petrol engine. And at this stage, you can say that you can do a standard analysis of a diesel engine, assuming it to be a closed cycle and all that, and you will get the standard slightly complicated formula for the efficiency of a diesel engine. The question then comes up is, what is a dual cycle? Dual cycle, or sometimes called dual combustion cycle. There is no new cycle, but remember that what we have done here is we have said that the model is approximate constant pressure heat addition. But this is not a very good approximation. It is a sort of acceptable, but if you want to do a better approximation, that is what is done in a dual cycle. In dual cycle, it is assumed that part of the combustion takes place at constant volume, followed by the remaining part of the combustion which takes place at constant pressure. You have the compression process from 1 to 2, then instead of 2 to 3 at constant pressure, you assume that part of it is at constant volume, part of it is at constant pressure. Let us say, you can say this is 2 prime, and then 3 to 4 as earlier, and 4 to 1 the exhaust process. Okay. So here 2 to 2 prime is constant volume, 2 prime to 3 is constant pressure. This is just a new or a different model for combustion in a diesel engine. At this stage, we can come to the, at least the power cycles based on gas, and then you say that, look, we have not yet explored the option of vapor cycles. And we tell the students that water is a ubiquitous material available in reasonable pure form. We know all the properties of it. It is rather easy to evaporate it at various pressures. We know how to condense it. We know all the properties of water. It has good heat transfer characteristic. So it should be a good working fluid for a power plant. And yes, it is a good working fluid for a power plant. But then when we try to implement this, we suddenly realize that if we take the Brayton cycle, which is the PSPS cycle, in which in one constant pressure process heat is added, in another constant pressure process heat is rejected. And then if we say that during this constant pressure process of heat addition, we make the fluid evaporate, and during this constant pressure process, if we make the fluid condense, then because at constant pressure you have two phases together, this would essentially be a constant temperature process. Similarly, during heat rejection, although we are doing it at constant pressure, because condensation takes place, this would also be a constant temperature process. So if you include this evaporation and condensation of a vapor substance or a phase changeable substance like water, then you can essentially implement a Brayton cycle, but what finally you will end up with is effectively a TSTS cycle, which is nothing but the Carnot cycle. That is the attraction of vapor cycles for us. It is easy for us to implement constant pressure heating and cooling. We do that. So we say that we are doing only constant pressure heating and constant pressure cooling. But during heating, we arrange that the fluid evaporates. During cooling, we arrange that the fluid condenses. And this evaporation and condensation at constant pressures turn out to be essentially at constant temperature, leading us to an indirect implementation of the Carnot cycle. Let us try to do this and see what happens. What we have is, naturally it will be a multi-equipment cycle. We will show it on the TS diagram and we will say this is the critical point. This is the saturated liquid line, this is the dry saturated vapor line, and let us say that we decide to work our cycle between a TH and a TL. And then we can arrange the cycle as a rectangle within this. Maybe the maximum rectangle can be something like this. This is our PL and this is our PH. So although we are doing a constant pressure heat addition and constant pressure heat rejection combined with two isothermal processes, isentropic processes, these two isobaric processes are also isothermal processes. Consequently, if you implement this, this is Brayton cycle with vapor and fully in the two phase zone. And this is nothing but a Carnot cycle, and the efficiency of this will be 1 minus TL by TH. However, when you try to implement this in practice, the block diagram will look like this. If I have these as four states, the block diagram will show a boiler in which heat is added, a turbine, three to four. Almost isentropic, the work is done. A condenser in which heat is rejected, and a compressor in which this wet steam here will be compressed and made available to the boiler. When you do this, the problem that arises is this wet steam compressor. We have had a problem with a compressor earlier, but remember there we were compressing almost dry saturated steam, dryness fraction 0.95. If you look up here, the dryness fraction of 1 will be pretty low, and it will start off as a compressor but end up like a pump, because at the end we have only saturated liquid. So this compressor is a technologically difficult thing to implement. So what is done is, such an implementation never takes place. What we do is the following. Let me change the color of my pen so I can show the modification in a different color. This one is shifted from wherever it is to the saturated liquid state. And then at the saturated liquid state, we pump it, because now it is a liquid, to the new state 2, which is at the higher pressure but at a temperature much lower than TH. And the heat addition now starts from this lower temperature 2, subcooled heating first, then evaporation, and then we come to 3. The current implementation of this cycle, and during the chat I have been asked whether it is a Brayton cycle or a Rankine cycle. What I showed you is the Brayton cycle, now as modified with those small red markers in the previous thing, we will call it the Rankine cycle. So this part of the cycle remains as it is, 3 to 4. Okay. Here this is the pH line, high pressure line. This is the low pressure line, PL. But we do the condensation right up to saturated liquid. Then we pump it, and then we have part of the heating at increasing temperature, part of the heating is at constant temperature. So from the Carnot cycle, we have given up a corner, it is not a rectangle anymore. And this cycle, the modified Rankine cycle used for, it is actually a Rankine cycle, because it is actually a Brayton cycle, because it is a PS. Out of this, the heat rejection turns out to be at constant temperature, but the heat absorption is not really at constant temperature. Part of it is at constant temperature, but part is not at constant temperature. This cycle is now known as the Rankine cycle. Okay. The block diagram now looks before as earlier, but traditionally the Rankine cycle block diagram is shown like this. We have the boiler in which heat is added. Rankine cycle will always be external combustion. Then we have a turbine. Then we have a condenser where some cooling stream, usually a water, usually cooling water from some surrounding lake or river or sea, is used. To cool it. So this is the condenser, this is the pump, this is the boiler, this is the turbine. States 1, 2, 3, 4. The pump W dot net will be W dot T minus W dot. However, because it is a vapor, now we cannot do any standard analysis for a given lower pressure, upper pressure, and the way it is implemented. We will have to work it out with steam tables every time. At this state, we have come to 13.4, where the basic cycles Brayton, Rankine, Otto and Diesel have been explained in some order. At this stage, you may decide to go over to the refrigeration cycles before going to modification of cycles and combination of cycles. So let us first look at refrigeration cycles. Again, just the way we have the major cycles are Brayton and Rankine, gas and vapor. There are corresponding cycles in the refrigeration scheme, which you can say inverted Brayton cycle and inverted Rankine cycle. The inverted Brayton cycle is quite often known as the Joule cycle. It is a gas cycle which is used for refrigeration. The inverted Rankine cycle, with its modification, does not have the name of a person, but is known as the vapor compression cycle. It is a good idea to start with the Joule cycle, because that is almost an unmodified version of a Brayton cycle, whereas vapor cycle is a modified version of a Rankine cycle. So when it comes to a Joule cycle, bring it to their attention that we need to have a T ref, temperature of the refrigerator space, and T ambient, where we can reject the heat. And a Brayton cycle is made up of two isentropics and two isobarics. So we lay out the two isentropics like this. And the two isobars are like this. After doing this, we tell them that look, the cycle is laid out like this. And now let us see how it is made to work. We have at a low pressure an isobaric process in which heat is absorbed from the cold space or refrigerated space. Then we have an isentropic process 1 to 2 in which the temperature of the working fluid is raised by compression to a temperature higher than the ambient, because notice 4 to 1 is a isobaric heating process where the temperature is below T ref, except at T1 it will just reach T ref. We want to reject it to ambient, so we must raise the temperature of this to a level above the ambient. So we raise it by doing this compression 1 to 2. Then we reject the heat to the ambient in an isobaric process at pH 2 to 3 and again reduce the temperature below that of the refrigerated space by doing an isentropic expansion. So this is made up of four processes: an isobaric heat addition 4 to 1, isentropic compression 1 to 2, isobaric heat rejection. This is where Q dot 1 is rejected to the surroundings, and isentropic reduction in pressure or expansion 3 to 4. The block diagram will be seen like this. You have the heat exchanger in the cold space going from 4 to 1. Then you have the compressor. Which will take this low pressure gas, typically air, at state 1 and compress it to state 2. This is the compressor. Power will need to be supplied to the compressor. Then you have the heat exchanger which does heat rejection. Here Q dot 2 is absorbed, here Q dot 1 is rejected, and then you have a turbine. You have a turbine which produces some power output. This is state. The net power required will be the power required to drive the compressor minus the power which comes out of the turbine. You can do a standard analysis and determine COP and any other parameters you feel like. Now at this stage, it is necessary to tell them, maybe going back or even otherwise, that the work ratio of a Brayton cycle, work ratio of a Brayton cycle, Otto cycle or diesel cycle, is typically of the order of 0.25, 0.3, which is good. It's nowhere near 1. But when you come to Rankine cycle, tell them that and demonstrate it using a illustrative diagram, that for a Rankine cycle, the power consumed by the pump is a very small fraction, usually fraction of a percent of the power delivered by the turbine. Consequently, here the work ratio is very small, less than 0.01, and which is a very attractive thing for any Rankine cycle plant. When it comes to implementation, we find that for the gas turbine cycles, the compressor and the turbine are invariably mounted on the same shaft, because so much, a significant fraction of the turbine power, something like 20-30%, needs to be made available to the compressor. And we don't want to lose anything of that in, you know, bearings, gearboxes and things like that. So we have a direct drive on the same shaft. Compressor and turbine are mounted. But in a steam plant, the power required by the pump is so small that we don't directly couple it to the turbine, either directly or through a gearbox or a belt drive. We let the turbine produce whatever the power it wants to produce and provide a separate drive, maybe a very small turbine or a small electric pump, to take care of the power required by the pump. So remember, Rankine cycle has a very small pressure ratio, Carnot cycle has a very large pressure ratio, almost 1. Rankine cycle typical pressure ratio is 0.01, sometimes even lower. Brayton cycles, depending on the parameters of pressures and temperatures, is typically 0.2, 0.25, 0.3. Now, because the Joule cycle is an inversion of the Brayton cycle, the turbine will produce maybe 30-40% of the power which the compressor needs, and hence to reduce the external power supply to the compressor, here also the turbine and compressor are arranged on the same shaft. Now you come to the inversion of the Rankine cycle. But now remember, if you look at the Rankine cycle, if you invert it, you will find that the heat rejection will now take place. Just consider this Rankine cycle going in the opposite direction, 1 to 4, 4 to 3, 3 to 2 and back to 1. And because heat will be absorbed from 1 to 4, you will have the refrigerated space temperature nearly equal to 1 to 4. And what about heat rejection? Heat rejection will take place from 3 to 2. And the temperature of 2 is not significantly higher than 1. So that means the point 1, the cold space temperature or the heat absorption temperature will not be significantly below the ambient. That will be a disadvantage. So what we do is we go back to our original Brayton cycle idea, where we worked it as a Carnot cycle. And then you say that, look, if we implement it like this, then since the process is 4 to 3, now it will be a process of compression, and 2 to 1, process of expansion, are adiabatic, I can have heat rejection to the ambient at 3 to 2, a high temperature, and heat absorption from the ambient 1 to 4 at a low temperature. But when you do that, let me sketch it and show you what happens. Let me now take Rankine inverted, or I should not really say, you should say Brayton inverted with a vapor and fully in the two phase zone. Now this is T ambient, this is T refrigerated space. Now I will have compression like this, I will have cooling like this, I will have expansion like this, and I will have heat absorption like this. So heat will be absorbed here, Q2, in the so called evaporator. Heat will be rejected to the ambient, Q1, in the so called condenser. This will be the compressor, which will compress it from a lower pressure to a higher pressure, and this will be the turbine or expander, which will expand it from the higher pressure back to the lower pressure. The higher pressure isobar will go like this, PH, the lower pressure isobar will go like this, PL. Well, if you try to implement it like this, there are two issues which come up in its implementation. One issue is that the compressor is starting with wet vapor, and although it's good to have, it's not very difficult to have wet vapor, we do not mind compressing it. In fact, we would like to evaporate it fully and then compress it like this. This is the modification which we do. Second thing is, rather than expanding this, this turbine or expander here will be a very complicated device because it is starting with a liquid, and as it gets depressurized, it will start evaporating. And that evaporation also will have to be taken care of. It's an adiabatic process, but the change in volume during this expansion would be very, very high. And because of that, this process is replaced by a throttling process. now the resultant cycle, known as the vapor compression cycle, looks like this. This is the higher temperature, but more important is this is the pH isobar. This is the lower pressure isobar. This is the lower temperature. This is, let me say TH, but this is not isobar. The lower pressure isobar will go like this. We start with dry saturated steam at the lower pressure, compress it, ideally isentropic compression. If I say this is 1, this is 2, 2 to 3 is heat rejection. Usually at the end of compression you find that the vapor is superheated, so part of the heat rejection is desuperheating, part of the heat rejection is condensing. So 2 to 2 prime, then to 3. At 3, we put it through a throttling valve or a capillary and come to state 4. This way, we lose out the work which we could have perhaps obtained in this turbine or expander, but that is a very small amount of work compared to what we will have to do in the compressor. So even if we lose out on that, there is no significant degradation in performance. Moving the evaporation from this point, wet vapor point, to dry saturated vapor point, not only healthy for the compressor, but it will also make the compressor very long lasting. I mean, it can be designed to have a very long life. This can be now shown in a block diagram as follows. 4 to 1, the heat absorption process is implemented in a heat exchanger known as the evaporator, because in it the refrigerant evaporates. Absorbs. Gets compressed. Then condenses. Goes through the throttling device. 1, 2, 3, 4. In the throttling device, if we arrange areas appropriately, H4 will be equal to H3. So notice that this vapor compression cycle has an isentropic compression, isobaric heat rejection, part of it turns out to be isothermal, isobaric evaporation, most of it is isothermal, or the way it is shown here, it is definitely isothermal, and this is a device, throttling device. Shouldn't call it isenthalpic, but enthalpy at 3 to 4 is the same. So if you want to write it as a cycle, for example, the Joule cycle is a PSPS cycle, just like a Brayton cycle, but in the other direction. The Rankine cycle is also a PSPS cycle, but much of the P part is also becomes T because of evaporation and cooling. Whereas for the vapor compression cycle, you can say that it is a PSPH cycle. Heat is absorbed in one P, heat is rejected in another P, and part of these P cycles in part are at constant temperature. The constant P processes happen to be at constant temperature because of a change of phase. Now at this stage, tell them that because two lines are constant pressure and we have a line with constant enthalpy, instead of a TS diagram, a diagram with P as one of the variables, one of the coordinates is attractive. It could be PS, but remember that entropy is useful only to thermodynamic people like us, whereas enthalpy is useful because the work done or the power required for the compressor would directly be related to the enthalpy difference between 2 and 1. Similarly, the heat absorbed in the evaporator, the so-called refrigeration effect, is directly proportional to 1 and 4. And hence, instead of a TS diagram, a pH diagram is attractive. And you tell them that in the industry, when you practice, vapor compression cycles are usually plotted on a pH diagram. And if you go to your Moodle, you go to the stuff of interest in Moodle and go to charts. Okay. And you will find that it is not just charts, but it charts and tables. And you will find that on various pages, I think this makes it, you have a pressure enthalpy diagram for ammonia, then you have pressure enthalpy diagram for refrigerant 22. This is over a wider range of pressure and temperature. There is another diagram which restricts itself to the right of the saturated vapor line. If you see, that second diagram is in this zone. I do not know whether you see this on the, yes, I think you are seeing that on the screen, so that you can read it better. You should not be under the impression that you always work with diagrams. So for refrigerant 22, there are some properties, saturation properties also in the form of tables. And if you go to the library, you will find much more detailed tables and diagrams. And finally, this is the diagram for refrigerant 134A, which is the current replacement for the old refrigerant 12, which was used till about 10 years ago, 10-15 years ago in all household refrigerators. These three fluids I have included because I think there are exercises in the cycle analysis part CA1 onwards, which use one or more of these fluids. But if you go to the ASHRAE handbook or you go to the internet, you will find charts and tables for various refrigerants and various other fluids. And if a fluid is used as a refrigerant, be sure that the chart will be available in the pressure enthalpy diagram form. In fact, a PV diagram or a TS diagram may be difficult to find, but if a fluid is a candidate as a refrigerant, its pressure enthalpy diagram would definitely be available. So we can use this. The only disadvantage is these diagrams tend to be cluttered because, well, pressure and enthalpy are the coordinates, but you have constant entropy lines, you have constant temperature lines, and you have constant volume lines. So that's what makes the reading of this is a bit difficult. If you print it out, be sure that you get a good printer, but try to print it out or get it enlarged on an A3 size sheet, not on an A4 size sheet. If you really want to use this for solving problems, an A3 printout is necessary. Okay. So that brings me to the end of the basic cycles part, that is up to 13.5. We have talked about refrigeration cycles and Joule and vapor compression cycles. So now let me go back to where we left off. I showed you the pH diagram on the printed charts, but a few things about the pH diagram like this. The vapor compression cycle will always be in two parallel isobars, the pH and the PL. The dome for most of the fluid goes like this, with the critical point at the top, and the cycle will start with whatever points. Let me see, one is evaporator exit and it goes anticlockwise from that. So evaporator exit, then we have an isentropic which brings it to 2, this is the compression process, then you have the condensation, fully isobaric but only part of it from 2 to 2 prime in the 2 to 2 prime in the desuperheating zone and 2 prime to 3 in the condensing zone, so that part is isothermal. Then you have the throttling process, at least if you are solving this in the course of thermodynamics, you should show it by a dotted line, not by a continuous line, because we do not know what is happening in between. That brings it to 4, and 4 to 1 is the evaporation process. And the thing to note here is this is H2 minus H1. And this enthalpy difference is proportional to the compressor power. In this analysis, we will generally be neglecting any change in potential energy and kinetic energy. So W dot C will be m dot into this delta H, the difference between H2 and H1. Similarly, the refrigeration effect or the heat absorbed will be proportional to H1 minus H4. So this will be proportional to W dot C, and since we have a throttling process instead of the turbine, there is no other work transfer. There is nothing like a turbine or an expander which will give you some work which you can compensate with the compressor work. This is proportional to Q dot 2. Which technically is known as the refrigeration effect, and hence the ratio of this length, if this is plotted to scale, to this length is A, this length is B, the ratio of this length of A to length of B becomes H1 minus H4 divided by H2 minus H1. And which becomes proportional to, or which is equal to Q dot 2 by W dot C. So this straight away gives you the coefficient of performance. Okay, if you plot it on a reasonable scale, then you can even use a scale or a measuring a strip to measure these out in lengths and maybe almost graphically determine the coefficient of performance. We have not yet talked about the HS diagram. You may as well introduce them to the HS diagram on which Rankine cycles or turbine state spaces are often plotted. Unfortunately, for steam, the part of the HS diagram which is the saturated liquid line becomes very, very cluttered, so you can't really show what it is. The reason for that is the if this is the triple point, this is the critical point, then the saturated liquid line is all here and the dry saturated vapor line goes like this. So if you have a low pressure isobar like this and a high pressure isobar like this, this particular part is very, very small, that just not seen anywhere. So our diagram will be 1 to 2 isentropic, 2 to 3 isobaric, part of it at isothermal, 3 to 4 again isentropic, and 4 to 1 isobaric, again all of it isothermal. This is how the cycle will look. And again here notice that this is, we may call it delta H across the turbine, which will be proportional to the power output of the turbine. This will be delta H across the condenser, which is proportional to the thermal energy loss or cooling effect in the condenser. This will be, this is exaggerated, this is about only 1% of delta HT. This is delta HP proportional to the power absorbed in the condenser, and this is delta HB proportional to the power or the energy heat transfer rate into in the boiler. Okay.